Hello everyone. This episode is about distributed hash table technique for transferring of files in the peer-to-peer network. Here we'll present what is a hashing technique. Then we describe about what is a distributed hash table and how circular DHTs are being used and what are the drawbacks of that and how this technique can be used on the overlay networks. Before we proceed to the hashing technique, let us understand what a database table contains. So here in this example, a simple database table which has got two different columns. One column is on the name of a person and the other column is a value which has been assigned to that corresponding person. So here, this particular organization of the data in the form of key value pair. So here the key considered in this example is the human name and the value is something like the Aadhaar number of that person. So if you see, this is a table in simple terms, a simple table consisting of several people and their corresponding names. And these are the sample data here and the corresponding value, which is nothing but it can be a Aadhaar ID number, or similar situation can be something like student name and student ID number, so on and so forth, or an employee name and an employee ID. So like this, you have several examples where your simple database table consists of two different columns. One is the key column or the attribute column and the corresponding value to that attribute or key. So when you arrange your data or your data has been organized in a database table, there's no problem here. You can store as many values as you can, and this is going to be a huge set of values. In other terms, this is going to become a large database. So in computer technology perspective, what happens is we are not going to store the large database in this corresponding form. It can be stored in another way for efficient retrieval of data or for searching process to be implemented properly, or to have various mechanisms on the data or operations on the data. We can reorganize this storage of the data in some other similar manner, something like this. We use a table called hash table. This hash table is going to be mostly useful for storing and searching the data in a very efficient manner. So here we store and search the data based on the numerical representation of the key, that is the attribute. So instead of storing the data, that is the names of those person, we store the corresponding numerical representations of the names in the form of a particular key. So this key is basically is obtained by applying some operation on the original key, or applying some function on that particular original key, that is the name of the person. So you apply some kind of operation, that function on that particular respective name, and that name gets changed to a particular number. So this number here, it is just some operation. It can be a mathematical function which applies on the set of characters and the corresponding numbers have been obtained here. So these are the original keys, which is with respect to the human names, and their corresponding hash keys, which have been derived from applying a function, hash function, on that corresponding original key. And here you can see the right side column, which is nothing but your value, which is corresponds to that key. So once you store and arrange your data in like this, so it is going to be easy for searching by numbers or searching by values or corresponding vice versa. So this type of organization of the data is basically called as key value pairs. So what is exactly a distributed hash table? So a distributed hash table, we are going to distribute the key and the corresponding value pairs over a lack of peers. Peers here is nothing but basically your computers, the computers which are connected with each other in a peer-to-peer network. So where these key value pairs are evenly distributed over the peers. So whenever you want to retrieve some corresponding value, you can contact, you can get access to that particular value based on the key which has been available on a particular computer. So any peer can query the database with a key. So any peer means any computer can query the database with respect to the data which is available on that particular computer with a particular key. So database returns the corresponding value for the key you have been querying it. So to resolve the query, a small number of messages are to be exchanged among the peers. So when you have a peer-to-peer network, when computers are connected with each other, so you are going to have some kind of communication mechanisms so that that particular message exchanges between those computers will enable us to retrieve the data which is located at a particular system. So each peer only knows about a small number of other peers. So when you connect those computers in a peer-to-peer network fashion, which is another form of representation of connecting these computers, which is different from client-server model. So this peer-to-peer networking will enable us to retrieve the data in a particular manner where we can store and get the information very quickly rather than going and waiting for the servers to be responding. So this is going to be a robust to peers coming and going, in the sense that in a peer-to-peer network, a computer can join in the peer network and he can be off of the network, in the sense that a computer can be active for some time and it can be inactive for some other times. So when it is inactive, you cannot obtain the corresponding value which is present in that computer. When it is active, you can easily retrieve that particular data. So assigning key value pairs to the peers, how do we assign this? So the rule to be followed here is that assign a key value pair to the peer that is the closest ID, in the sense that the meaning of the closest is that it is going to be an immediate successor of that particular key. Assume that there are 64 computers and each computer is having an ID 0, 1, 2, 3, like this up to 63. So there are basically, once in a while, you can have all the 64 computers to be connected with each other and they can form a peer-to-peer network. Sometimes you may not be able to have all the 64 computers in the live, or in the sense that they are connect active all the time. So assume that there are certain 8 peers, something like computer 1, computer 12, 13, 25, 32, 40, 48, and 60 are connected with each other. So here, if you are going to look for a key value 51, so this key value 51 is located, or which has been assigned to a particular computer number 60, and which can retrieve that corresponding value corresponding to 51. So usually you are going to assign a particular key value to a particular computer. So that will enable us to retrieve the corresponding value from that particular computer. So this is how you are going to assign the key value pairs to the computers or your systems which you are in the same piece. So when these computers are connected to each other, so you come across something like a circular fashion because of the hashing technique that you are going to apply here. So this particular circular fashion of this distributed hashings or the distributed key value pairs among these computers, the technique is being said that it is in a circular manner. Each peer only is aware of immediate successor and predecessor in this formation of circular distributed hash table. So assume that computer 1 and computer 12, 13, 25, 32, 40, 48, 60 are being active here and they are connected with each other. And a computer 1 knows the successor. The successor of computer 1 is 12. Similarly, the successor of 12 is 13. And the predecessor of 13 is 12. And the predecessor of 12 is 1. And the predecessor of 60 is 48. Similarly, 48 predecessor is 40, and so on and so forth. So every computer knows its corresponding successor and the corresponding predecessors. So if you are arranging or your computers are connected in this manner, then the distributed hash table technique is applied on this set of computers. You can try to find out what is the value associated with the key 53 and which you, when you are located on system number 12. So when you are on system number 12, you would like to know what is the key that is being associated, or the what is the value that is being associated with the key 53. So you don't know where 53 is located among this set of peers. So in order to find out where that particular key 53 is located, or the key 53 is associated with which particular system, you can apply your circular DHT mechanism in such a way that you know the successor of 12. The successor of 12 sends a message to 13. The successor of 13 is 25. So 13 will send a message to 25 to get the value for key 53, and 53 is not available on this machine. So 25 sends a message to the next successor, that is 32. 32 also do not have the key value 53, so hence it is pass on that message to 40. Similarly, 40 sends a message to 48, and when 48 sends a message to 60, so 60 knows that 53 key is present at that particular node, and the corresponding value of that 53 is been now passed on to system number 12, which has been requesting that query, or it has been initiated that query. So if you see, in general, there are some messages which are passed across these peers. So something like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, then the seventh is the actual reply. So you are passing on 6 messages from one peer to another peer to find out whether that particular key is located on so and so such system. So here, if there are certain systems which are connected in the peer, something like lakhs of computers are connected, or millions of devices are getting connected over the internet, and those are connected in such a way that they are now peer-to-peer network. So if at all you want to search for a particular value on a particular machine across these millions of devices, then the number of messages that you need to be passed on will be enormous. So enormous in the sense that it will be order of n. So the big disadvantage of this circular DHT is that if there are going to be n devices, then definitely it will be a big O of n, a number of messages are to be passed across these computers or across these devices which are on the peer-to-peer. So here, the same thing here, when you are going to have, this is another diagram, node 1 to node 5, you are going to pass on, which is connected in a circular manner, so that the messages gets exchanged between each other to get the corresponding value of the respective queue, which is requested by one of the node in the peer network. So the performance of the file lookup is obviously a big O of n, which is the worst case, and it can be done with the help of linked list of n nodes. So in order to minimize this big O of n, the worst case of the number of messages that are going to be used in finding out where the exact key is located on the peer-to-peer network, so one technique is basically people use is one of the hashing technique. There are several other techniques too. So one of them has the hashing technique is allow nodes to know additional pointers to other nodes on the cord ring to speed up the lookup. So instead of sending a messages to the successor nodes, you can skip some of these successor nodes. So how do we skip, or what is that we are trying to find out the shortest distance, in other terms? So here there is some mechanism, the hashing technique, which has been applied in the distributed hashing table, so which we use it here, where small m denotes the number of bits in the key or the node identifier. So each node maintains a routing table of m entries. So the node in the circular hash tables, and each node maintains the number of entries, that is basically you call it as a routing table, and the routing table will enable us what is the shortest node that can be used to retrieve the requested queries value. So that is going to be seen from this particular diagram here. So there are node 8, node 13, node 29, node 37, node 46, node 51, followed by node 57. These are all connected in a circular manner, and all these nodes are been having the successor nodes like this. Node 8 successor is 13, node 13 successor is node 29, so node 29 successor is 37, and so on. So if you want to find out the what is the corresponding value for a node 53, and when you are located on node 8, so when you are located means you are present here and you like to know what is the corresponding value of 53. So where 53 is located, 53 is located, whether it is, it can be located here somewhere here, so you don't know that. So if you pass on from the circular manner from one successor to another successor, the number of messages will be more. So you can minimize this with the maintaining a routing table on each node, where that routing table will have the entries following certain hashing technique here. The hashing technique is basically, so 53, so totally the number of bits that can be used here are basically 6 bits. So when you use 6 bits here, so you can have the 6 bits used to represent, so 6 entries will be there, 6 entries on each node, and these 6 entries corresponds to the routing table here for that particular node. So here when you are on the node 8, you will have the information that node 8's the immediate successor is 13, then the immediate successor or after proceeding to 2 power 0, that is 13, 2 power 1 is 13, 2 power 2 is 4, 2 power 3 is 8, 2 power 4 16, 2 power 5 is 32. So whenever you are looking for something like the node 53, so usually the 53 contains the number of bits. That number of bits will indicate that is almost the number of bits are for 53 you are using as in the binary representation, that is in the form of 2 power m. So that is 2 power n is comes to 2 power 5. So node 8 plus 2 power 5, the nearest node is n46, the nearest node is n46. So you are skipping the messages that are been to be traversed between the successor nodes, and you are directly coming to the shortcut. That is the shortcut, that is a chord, we call it as. This chord will directly will enable to give that information of the availability of the node 53 coming to 46, and that is with only one message it comes to 46, and from 46 to 51 and 51 to 53. So 53 is going to be available at the 57 and it gets back the messages. So here we have only three messages are needed to find out where is the value for the key 53 when you are located on node 8. So here you are avoiding something like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Instead of 6 messages, you have come down to 3 messages. So you are by this in the, across the systems which are connected millions of devices, you can minimize the number of messages to be used to find out when the nodes are connected on the P2P network. So this is one of the distributed hashing table technique. Usually we use it so that you can retrieve the files which are located on different computers. So far in this first unit, we have covered something called client server model. Then we understood what are the services for this client server model. The basic is your connectionless service and followed by the connection oriented services and the application layer protocols such as the DNS, followed by the POP, IMAP, FTP, SSH, HTTP protocol, and some of the peer-to-peer networks design and their corresponding applications, what exactly they are going to be there. So basically there are two different models. One is client server model, another is peer-to-peer model. You have seen various characteristics of these two models that will have some understanding about how we can develop your web applications and how these web applications can be deployed across these two types of networks. Thank you.